The hand of the Lord is upon you, for he has brought you to this place. Too often we think these conventions are a place to chill, get away from the office for a bit, meet up with friends, fellowship with others, make new friends, appeal for funding in the hallway. But the hand of the Lord is upon you. He has brought us to this place. This is the mountaintop. You see, when the hand of the Lord is upon his leaders, that means he's moving freely and provoking us. We are not here to hear what we want. We are here to understand what God wants and allow him to challenge us to grow from where we are. I liked Oprah Winfrey's story of her life as she herself in her interview gave it. I brought tears to my eyes several times. She's this 20-something sitting at the anchor, I think in Atlanta, fresh out of college, and she did so well. She was so bubbly. She suddenly realized, I need to do more. And then she started this little talk show, AM something, or Good Morning Atlanta. It did so well that soon Baltimore came calling, and she went to Baltimore for 8 or 10 years, and Good Morning or AM Baltimore, and she was just this incredible person on the air, so spontaneous, so bubbly, and then she made the phrase that changed my life. I realized that I had stopped growing. And it was time to do something else. And so where does she go? Chicago, where, what was his name, the great talk show host with the white hair? Phil Donahue was King of Kings and Lord of Lords of the talk show circuit. On her opening show, she went way beyond Donahue's ratings. And she began to grow again. One day while she was interviewing Aryan nations and white supremacist leaders, up to a third of the audience were white supremacists, and they were shouting, they took over her show, and that's when she realized, I need to be more responsible, because people will commandeer me and use me as their voice piece. I will never do that again. I will never interview somebody who was fathered by an alien. I will never waste the public's time with stupidity. From now on, it's about family. It's about childhood. It's about marriage. It's about being human on planet Earth. And suddenly, it grew so much that she launched her own production company, Harpo Productions. That's Oprah spelled backwards. And then, for the next years, she became the Queen of Queens and Lord of Lords, until she realized she had stopped growing. And now she launched Oprah Network, and her highly successful show that she could have stayed with till retirement was done away with. Why is it that we have to watch others do incredible stuff and just go home and marvel and remain where we are year after year after year? We must become more restless. If I have stopped growing, it's time to go. Yet when we worry most is during election time. And we pray to God the nominating committee will be merciful unto us. And we start singing this song, Is My Name Written There? I read from the Word of God. Let's bow our heads. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, again, please mess with us. We did not come here just to hang out. We are here on your business. So speak, Lord. We are listening. Push us. Make us a bit uncomfortable. Force us today. Hold up a big mirror and force us to look at ourselves. As we hear this message from you, may we not think of someone else. May we not say in our heart, I hope she's listening, and I hope he's listening. May we ask ourselves, what are you telling me this morning? So again, take us to the edge of this cliff and push us off. As we fall helplessly, may we realize that we can fly, that we can soar like eagles. Enough crawling, Lord. Enough screeching from a nest. Totally destabilize us and push us off. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Are you serious about what you just amened? You know what you just did to yourself? The Word of God, Mark chapter 8, verse 1 and onward. During those days, another large crowd gathered. Since they had nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I have compassion for these people. They have already been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. If I send them home hungry, they will collapse on the way because some of them have come a long distance. His disciples answered, but where in this remote place can anyone get enough bread to feed them? How many loaves do you have? Jesus asked. And they said, we have 7 loaves. He told the crowd to sit down on the ground, and when he had taken the 7 loaves and given thanks, he broke them and gave them to his disciples to distribute to the people, and they did so. They had a few small fish as well, and he gave thanks for them and also and told the disciples to distribute them. The people ate and were satisfied. That's what happens when Jesus hands out the food. There was no heartburn. There was no acid reflux busting out in that crowd that day, for the Lord himself gave them to eat. They were satisfied. And here's the power. After they were satisfied, the disciples picked up 7 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. About 4,000 people were present. After he had sent them away, he got into the boat with his disciples and went to the region of Dalmanutha. The Pharisees came and began to question Jesus to test him. They asked him for a sign from heaven. He sighed deeply. Why does this generation ask for a sign? I'm telling you, no sign will be given to it. And he turned and he left them and got back into the boat and crossed to the other side. Now on the boat, the disciples realized that they had forgotten to bring bread. Except for 1 loaf. That's only 1 tortilla among 13 guys. And we all know that's not enough. They had only 1 loaf in the bread. Be careful, Jesus warned them. Watch out for the leaven, the yeast of the Pharisees and that of Herod. See, the Pharisees for their theology, the Herodians for their politics driven by theology. They discussed this with one another and said, oh, it's because we have no bread. Now, he's mad because we didn't bring enough bread on the boat. So don't you have the leaven of the Pharisees? Be careful about this. And Jesus, aware of their discussion, asked, Why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see and ears but fail to hear? Don't you remember when I broke 5 loaves, 5,000 people ate? How many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up? 12, they replied. And when I broke the 7 loaves for 4,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up? And they answered, 7. And he said to them, do you still not understand? Those are the rare moments when Jesus breaks down with his own conference and union and division leadership. After 3 years of training, these men still did not get it.
Well, I've been trained by the best. Not that I've learned anything.
Sometimes we think our titles make us important. Shame on us. I'm a disciple. I'm a Talmudim. He came to me and said, Lech Acharai, and I did. He confronts them because he asks them three key questions. Number one, are your hearts hardened? You guys think I'm talking about a single loaf of bread? How many did I feed on a mountain with the 5,000? You had all these baskets full left over, 12. And then 4,000 with a, you're asking about a loaf of bread? When I'm telling you that the leaven of the Pharisees is dangerous? Have you hardened your hearts? You know, back then in biblical times, they believed the heart was what we know now as the mind. As a man thinketh in his heart, do you think in your heart? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. So as you think, that's who you are. In the Pauline correspondence, we see in Romans 10:10, with heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. We can believe with our hearts. In other words, our minds. If you harden your heart, Pharaoh was confronted. Let my people go. And he hardened his heart. Moses says, well, the Lord hardened it. I'm fascinated in the switching back and forth in the Hebrew in that narrative. As God hardens his heart, then there are other places where Pharaoh hardens his heart. Fascinating. There are times when committee hardens its heart, and there's times when we proudly harden our hearts and actually give a Bible verse in explanation. He hardened his heart. One plague after another. Okay, take away the frogs and you guys could go worship somewhere. After the frogs were gone, he hardened his heart until the 10th plague when his son died. There's not much left to debate when you lose a child. Go thou with thy people and take thy animals. Go and worship the Lord and leave this land. My eyes shall never look upon thee again. Get out of here. And as they began to cross the Red Sea, he hardened his heart again. And he saw the mighty Egyptian army die before his eyes as the Red Sea closed upon them. Hardening your heart is more than being stubborn, because I know that there's no stubbornness in your life. I know my wife is very faithful in reporting my stubbornness. You know, you're just so, I know. I'm stubborn. Amen. Finally, you preach something that, amen. Hardening your heart is more than being stubborn. It's a closed mind. You've already decided. You've made an opinion you've held on to for 30 years, and nobody's going to change your mind. Are your hearts hardened? Jesus asked his disciples. Is it possible that you see and yet you're not seeing? Is it possible that you hear and you're not hearing me? Because spiritual things are spiritually discerned. It's like Nicodemus coming to Jesus at night. You must be born again, but I'm I'm approaching retirement, and how do I go back into my mom's body? A scholar, a demon from Andrews. How do I go back into my mother's body? You must be born of water. And when someone is baptized, what happens? You are born of the Holy Ghost descends on you. It is spiritually understood. Which begs the question, are we being led by the Spirit? Or are we being led by doctrine and opinion and tradition and culture, which varies from country to country? I land in the XYZ country, and immediately I am confronted by union leadership. Why do you not have your wedding band? I'm Adventist. In our country, if you don't wear your wedding band, you are announcing you're available. You're messing with your marriage. Put something on. And they show me the quotes that I need to understand this. I leave that country. I fly to the neighboring country. As I'm getting off the plane, oh, good, you don't have a wedding band. Because you just came from that other country where all of them are sinning. Here, we don't allow jewelry. Is God that confused that he doesn't know what he wants? Now, listen carefully to me. I'm not trying to listen. Listen in the spirit. I'm not wanting to mess with you, but we have a challenge among us because all those people come to live to North America. And you go to this part of your field and a wedding band is anathema. You go to that part of the field and they're all a bunch of liberals who wear wedding bands. Culture informs our theological interpretations. You can argue it all you want, but those of us who travel way too much and unnecessarily are seeing something every week somewhere on this continent. I've still been dismissed from a church for having a guitar, the devil's instrument. And it wasn't Tennessee, Texas, or Kentucky, because the guitar is the harp spoken of in Scripture. You bring in a guitar, oh, praise the Lord. But this other church, I'm sorry, that cannot come into the house of God. And they give me the passages to prove it. We, like Abraham Lincoln once said, we all quote from the same Bible. And we all ask for God's aid against the other. Who is God gonna listen to? This is the leadership dilemma that you and I confront. There are fallacies of argumentation. One of the first fallacies is name calling. When you disagree with, oh, you're just a liberal. That's it. You've shut down the conversation. How can I talk with somebody if right away I'm a liberal or a conservative or a, oh, you're just a moderate. You're lukewarm. This is what's happening with our politics in the nation. That's why you must make sure that politics does not enter your leadership. Oh, the greatness of Canada, America, and Bermuda is that we can have our political convictions. Your life is your business. Your convictions are your business. But when you make that your ministry, you are sinning before the Lord your God. Be careful, because every congregation has conservative politically and liberal politically. If you take a side, you have driven people out. God called us to lead, not to drive. Sometimes we hurt our own. I have my convictions. I'm always in trouble. If I work with Democrats, my Republican friends are convinced that my soul is in danger and that I need to repent. And if I work with Democrats, if I work with Republicans, my Democratic friends are the same way. You've sold out, man. God did not call me to take a side. Either we love our country or we don't. There is no party that has all the answers. Only Jesus Christ has them. So get over it. We must rise above the political circle. We can help influence politics by not getting into the thick and leading in the name of Jesus. Health ministry is a powerful statement that all parties are excited about. Or the Adventists, I'm telling you. And they're fascinated by us. You meet one Adventist and he's a kill every Democrat conservative. Then you meet another Adventist and it's I hate everybody liberal Democrat. And they're all Adventists. Isn't that cool? We can actually do God's work in spite of who we are. Another fallacy of argumentation is overgeneralization. Well, everybody's doing it now. The church, I remember when Celebration started in Colton, California, suddenly there was a scandal that went worldwide. There were only four Celebration churches on planet Earth. Everything is falling apart. And I would put in my church bulletin as a pastor in Bakersfield, Celebration in study for Sabbath school, Celebration of worship for church. And I was no longer allowed by the board to use the word because it became a cuss term in Adventism. All because four little churches called themselves Celebration. They had a praise band. The fallacy of generalization. Jesus confronted his disciples. The leaven of the Pharisees was their doctrine. They stood there the same way after the 4,000. They did it after the 5,000. It was the day John the Baptist died. When John died, he was beheaded. That morning, Jesus is informed, so he had to grieve. Let's go, get into the boat. And he wanted to go to a quiet place to grieve. But there he goes. And the people followed along shore. I mean, that's messed up. He's wanting to go cry quietly somewhere. As they're coming ashore, thousands of people are waiting on him. And what did he do? He healed sick people all day long. He cast out demons. He preached the most powerful 8-hour sermon you've ever heard in your life. And at the end of the day, these folks are hungry. And some kid came up, was brought up by Philip with a basket. Sweet, can I borrow your basket, mijo?
My mommy gave it to me.
Can I borrow your stuff? I'll give it back.
My mommy gave it to me, and I'm hungry.
I'll give it back.
My mommy gave it to me. I'm hungry.
Isn't it cool? That must have been cool when Jesus handed the basket with his 5 loaves and 2 veggie fish still in it. Morning Star Farms. As he kept breaking the tortillas, as he kept breaking the veggie fish so that everybody can have mini tacos that wonderful evening. The only thing he was missing was jalapenos with the onions and the... Everyone ate till they were filled. And 12 baskets were left. And Jesus tells the disciples, you guys go on ahead, I'll catch up. There's only one boat. Go on ahead. I'll catch up. Master, solo hay un barco, por favor, haga caso. Go, I'll join you. I know, I tried to tell him, but he's not listening. See, Jesus doesn't do things the way we want. We don't always have to understand his will. Just obey. We debate obedience so much that we stop obeying. Both sides. Obedience! No, it's faith. Obedience, faith. Neither is obedient. And neither is showing faith. I hate you in the name of Jesus. I get those letters, do you? It would be better, Elder Rojas, that you had never been born. That's a quote. This sister wanted me dead. That you had never been born, the souls of thousands of innocent youth will be your responsibility. But don't get me wrong, I love you. I'm supposed to be dead, but sister loved me. She loves me to death. I said, this letter I don't ever want my mother to even know about. As they left on the boat, the priest who had been there all day long, who saw him heal people, who saw him cast out demons, who heard his words from on high, this kingdom, my kingdom, is not of this world. At the end of the day, see him feeding thousands of people, and they walk up to him and say, show us a sign. Why? Because the spiritual work that Jesus was doing was not being perceived. It did not fit into the theological construct that Mashiach was going to be a military leader who was going to deliver us from Rome, not from our sins. And they refused. They hardened their hearts. They closed their minds. They did not see it nor discern it. Show us a sign. After a day full of signs and wonders and miracles, prodigios, milagros, show us a sign. And these were the conference and union leaders of the time. This was the division and general conference, Sanhedrin as well. And now you have the second feeding of 4,000, and the same thing happens. Show us a sign. And Jesus, in front of this, I'm not going to give you a sign. On the first time, he says, except the sign of Jonah. Remember what the sign of Jonah was? Repent. Open your minds and repent, and God will spare. These guys were not going to repent because they weren't wrong. They had the quotes to prove it. We face a dilemma, brothers and sisters. I think when Pharaoh was called on by God and he hardened his heart, it's because he didn't realize it was bigger than him. He's only Pharaoh, the leader of the greatest and most powerful nation on earth at the time. But he's dealing with God, the only power in the universe. It was bigger than him. And what does he do? He hardens his heart. And now Jesus is making it clear, it's bigger than you all. And you harden your hearts. I get on a boat with you and you only have one tortilla. And you think, oh, he's mad about the tortilla. That's why he's bringing the leaven statement. Beware of the leaven. You guys, don't you get it? Brothers and sisters, I'm convinced that Jesus Christ is coming soon. You're not? I'm convinced that Jesus Christ is coming soon. Amen. Seriously, think about it. What is our culture? Well, the time of trouble hasn't happened yet. We too have expectations of the second appearing of Mashiach. Unless this happens and that happens and that happens, I ain't even going to start listening to you. Our people have begun to harden their hearts. And we have leaders the same way. The hand of the Lord is upon you, for he has brought us to this place. Something's going on that's bigger than us, and we cannot harden our hearts at this point of the journey, because if we harden our hearts, seeing we will not see, hearing we will not hear what God has to say for us. This is our time to awaken from slumber. But we've been doing this for 25 years. Who do you think? I don't know who I am. I'm a nothing. Just ask my opponents. I mean, that dude has issues. I already know I'm nothing. Please do not write your letter. I already know. You don't have to persuade me. People like you are nothing. Thank you. I've known that for a long time, and that's why I'm wondering why they even asked me to speak. I'm afraid. You're better than me. That's why I believe in you. Something bigger than us is happening. God is moving. And when Ellen White describes the latter rain of the Holy Spirit, she says that those who were not ready, The latter rain will be falling on souls all around them. They will not see it nor discern it because their hearts are hardened. Their minds are cold. Well, this is not the time of trouble, so this must not be from God. We have made charts and graphs, something we were specifically advised not to do, to rely on whether we should move or not, whether we should pray or not. If the Pope sneezes, that's it, the Sunday law's coming. Now, I'm not making less of it. Prophecy's prophecy, it speaks for itself. One day persecution will come upon us. Bring it on. Soldiers are unafraid to die for the cause. If somebody come after me, you watch yourself, because Daniel chapter 12, verse 1 says, there shall be a time of trouble since there never was, since there was a nation, even to that time. You see? No, finish reading it. And at that time, my people shall be delivered. Why do we leave off the last sentence? It's a message of deliverance. We have made it a message of woe. We have scared ourselves into paralysis. There are church members who cannot win a soul because they're busy trying to save their own. I don't want, I got 1,000 cans of food buried in the backyard. Why would you waste food like that when there are hungry people in town trying to save your? Now, I go to countries where folks are dying because they get caught with a Bible. And they say, what's with you North Americans? Afraid of times of trouble when those of us who've been persecuted all our lives, the Lord has preserved us. Now, some of us die, but we know that going in, that there are prices to pay. Some of us may give our lives. When Dr. King stood before the march, he told the people, love your abuser. Pray for the man who beats you with the baton and hits you with the fire hose. And then he made a statement. You cannot drive out darkness with darkness. You need light to do that. You cannot drive out hate with hate. You need love to do that. It says we will obey all traffic regulations. We will march in an orderly fashion. We will sing to the Lord a new song. Some of us will fill jail cells. Some of us will even die, but our death will be redemptive. So folks joined with Dr. King, knowing they may die. You see, when you believe in something, it's worth dying for. If you are afraid of the time of trouble, I must ask you, what do you believe in if you're so afraid to die? This is our time. We must awaken. The hand of the Lord is upon us. He has brought us to this place. This is our time to move, not debate. We can discuss our views as we work. You know, if you have a better way to win a soul, show me. Don't come and criticize how I bring a baptism to God. Why, you just didn't preach enough of this or that. You weren't listening. I covered that in my second message. Well, not enough. Well, how many baptisms do you have? Those who don't play the game should not attempt to make the rules. We have folks. There are three kinds of church members and three kinds of leaders. I am not thinking of anybody. I praise God Almighty. My mind is blank. I'm afraid to be up here. I should be somewhere else very far away today. From a political perspective, this is public suicide. I'm telling you right now, When I look at the three kinds of leaders or church members, there are the tired. Those who have worked, those who have labored, those who have suffered, they carry the burden of battle. They're moving slower, but they're still at it. The tired. Then there are the tiresome. Those are the ones who don't do anything and consider themselves the expert on everything. And whenever you try to do something, they criticize you for it. So they don't do and they don't allow to do. Those are the tiresome. Then there are the tireless. those who do and don't know how to stop. Brothers and sisters, we need to become tireless. And those of us who are tired, we need to mentor in some energetic people. And those who are tiresome, sit down. I sat on a committee with General Colin Powell when we were launching the Alliance for Youth. All right. And this man takes off his jacket and rolls up his sleeves. Very intimidating. We all kept our jackets on. And he gets, all right, let's get to work. Let's look at the list. We had 300 organizations that agreed to launch tutoring under their sphere of influence. All right. The Adventists. Oh, sir. 81 sites, sir. Good work. Keep up the good work. I can die now. Amen. And how about so-and-so, sir? We have over 100 organizations that have not yet begun. Wait, it's been over a year since their commitments. Dump them. We have no room for people who do nothing. I'm sitting there. This is scary, man. You have the need to call this man sir, even though he's a civilian. You just feel this need when he walks by. And then he says, dump him. And he takes off his glasses. Folks, lead, follow, or get out of the way. And he puts his glasses back. Yes, sir. I didn't do anything wrong. Here we were the ones who did well at the table, and I was scared. There's power when God's people make up their mind to soften their hearts and let the Holy Ghost come in and be led by the Spirit, to be driven by prayer. Prayer is not what you do to start a program. Prayer is not what you do to eat legally. Oops, I forgot to pray. Sweetheart, why don't you pray? I prayed this morning. How come you never asked Jeff? I don't want to pray. And this huge fight breaks out over the table because nobody wants to pray. Is that what prayer is in our lives? Don't raise your hand, just your conscience. Talking directly with the King of Kings and Lord of Lords is reduced to a legal formality? Are you kidding me? When all the power of the universe is available to us, we've reduced it to start and end a program. We have thousands of people per year. I want you to pray for me. And what do we say to them? Of course I will. And you walk away and you forget you made that promise. With me, my wife, I notice you promising her. Don't you ever do that again. What am I supposed to do? Pray with her. So people say, I need your prayers for my son. And I pull her, what's your son's name? On the spot, we pray. You don't go make empty promises. The power of prayer must be claimed now in our lives. It is not preparation for the work. It is the work. You can tell who's praying because the Holy Ghost is all over them. It's not technique. It's not methods. You will always have your methods, your techniques, what works in your field. Nobody should challenge what you're doing, because if the Holy Ghost lives within you, if you are driven by the power of prayer, there is nothing we cannot do. We can go where he sends us. We can say what he has us to say. Don't harden your heart. Soften your heart. It's our time, brothers and sisters. We now have social networking upon us. It never asked our permission. When I first went to NAD, I actually stumbled into Ellen White in the hallway. It's been a while. I mean, it was 30 pounds ago. I mean, it's been a while. I was a skinny kid there. People called me young man. All that has dreadfully ended. Nobody's calling me young man anymore except my parents. But brothers and sisters, I've seen something. And it didn't come from humans. There is no committee that can vote what God wants to do. God moves on our members. And then the committee scrambles to catch up with what God is doing in the field. And here the whole time we hear complaints that the office is out of touch at the conference or at the union or at the GC or whatever. But the Lord has been moving. It's just folks are so blind, seeing they do not see, hearing they do not hear. It is time that we all synchronize. Why? Because when I read Matthew 24, 14, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached to all the world as a witness unto me. Then the end will come. That's how you know Jesus is about to come. The gospel has reached around the globe. And I thought that means we're all holding evangelistic meetings by the thousands. Well, let that be. Let us be holding evangelistic meetings by the thousands. We don't want to diminish that, but that is not the only tool God is going to use. It's called social networking. Dog it, criticize it all you want, but it's upon us. My little experiment of the last year, I now have 1.5 million people following me all day long on Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn. And I'm going to add a few more. You know why? Because it's an experiment. Can it be that our church members who are already on here, probably most of our members who have hundreds, some of them thousands of friends and acquaintances, most of them are not believers, if they begin to testify with what they have seen Jesus do in their lives? You see, on the day of Pentecost, it says on that first day, 3,000 people were added. It actually gives the mathematical term, were added to the faith that day. The next day, another few thousand were added to it. See, that's the power of evangelism. It's addition. It adds people. I hold meetings all the time. I keep my credentials current. I'm now committed to reach out to the secular mind, the educated mind, mostly Caucasian, but second, third generation Latino and every other culture as well, because I want to see that this thing about impossible be proven untrue. How can we tell the Holy Spirit, these people don't respond to you? Maybe it's us not being responsive to the Spirit. We must allow ourselves somewhere to open our minds further. Perhaps I don't know everything after all, because this world has shifted to a technological virtual reality. And I'm telling you right now, I had 12 countries yesterday respond. I said, I'm going to teach a seminar on how to use social networking for outreach. And people from around the world, are you streaming this? We need this. Can you please record it for us? And now there's a yearning from lay people who are doing stuff that our committees can never vote on. The nature of our job description is shifting before us. Right under our feet, God is changing the ground that we stand on. Sooner or later, we're going to take off our sandals because the ground we stand on is holy. Yeah. Yes, sir. Yeah. Today's model is not about power. If you have a powerful position, I am vice president forever and ever. Amen. You know the field doesn't care about that. They only know if you're making sense to their kid, if you're feeding their marriage, if you're helping them take one more step toward Jesus. They're not asking, what is your title? So today's paradigm in a virtual reality is not what position do you hold or what power you possess. It's what influence do you have? Because now billions of people are talking. There are conversations going on right now. Social networking has now far surpassed pornography as the biggest traffic worldwide. It is the third largest country in the world, Facebook. But if you add all the social networks together, they are the second largest country in the world. They are talking already. Our church members are there. Our young people, our young adults are already there. The question is, are we there? Because if we don't talk to our church members, someone else will. The definition of leadership now is to influence in places we never imagined existed. And those who refuse to adjust, the Lord is going to remove you. So I'll be in my district by next month. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, what we are seeing is seismic. If we don't see it, then we must ask God about our hearts. If we haven't heard this, then we need to examine our hearts. Has our mind closed? I think about our fights that we have in church. We fight over things that are not important, no matter how important each proponent thinks it is, complete with quotes. If that's what you think ministry is, fighting, instead of winning the soul of the person who lives directly across the street from the sanctuary. No, we're going to fight over the relationship between faith and works. Faith without works is dead. No, it's faith alone. Faith without works. Who did faith? Let's pray. The Sabbath school class is over. Meanwhile, somebody across the street has never seen your faith or your works. See, isn't that what we're about? That church member inspired to cross the street and win that soul? Call it what you want. Evangelism, call it outreach, call it discipling. Use the term. Take the path that God gave you, but get our members over there. They really want to be. Young adults know that we're never going to give them a department. You know why? Because a young adult department doesn't work for them. They're already talking with each other. They're already networked. What they want is someone to talk with in the church leadership. Somebody to bring them together and raise themes that can inspire them. These are educated young people. They're no longer students. When you think young adult, you're still thinking the teenager. No, that's the kid. You can have a department for kids. That's why we have Pathfinders. That's why we have camping. But young adults are now a reality. Most of our college students are in public campuses. There's no money for them. They have found their own way. We better join them quickly. The power of this ministry is that it's already happening, and the Lord is wanting us now to shift gears quickly and adapt. Are your hearts hardened? Jesus asked them. Do you see and do not see? Do you hear and do not hear? One of the truths about virtual reality is that this reality is constantly shifting. I invite you to use your computer more often. Now, I know you're already on. Remember when the computer came into the office? In 1993, when I first got to the division, one of the secretaries, bless her heart, she had her degree in clerical, and she had her IBM Selectric. She said, I'm sorry, I don't know about those newfangled computers. I know what works. And the NAD went silent because you used to have 1,000. Now there was nothing. Nobody works here. It's silent. That's what PCs did. And she refused. She said, I'm sorry, I can't. No, but look, this will spell check it for you. There's no whiteout. No, I've been doing this all my. She refused. Bless her heart, she retired 6 months later. She could not make the adjustment. And we're all happy because a computer helps us with our work. And now email helps us because we don't have to write letters. We could just respond to our email, and that's the equivalent. It's a legally binding document that could be subpoenaed in a courtroom. We know we're happy with technology because it helps us with our work. No. This has redefined what work is. When I go onto a social network, I don't have time to chit-chat. I'm sharing what's happening. We're entering a committee. We're about to take action on this critical item. This item has a way of dividing the church. Please pray. And I get 1,000 responses from around the world. We are praying that the Spirit of God move on that meeting. Now, this is just little me who fits the profile for the bad guy at the airport, who fits the profile of the illegal alien in Arizona. Little me, this nobody. You don't even know what my title is unless you look at the program. You don't know what I heard he volunteers, or I'm not sure if he's paid. He's there. I don't know what he does. See, isn't that exciting? You have no clue what I do. Neither do the police. So if little me can be talking to 1.5 million people. What's the membership of NAD? I finally became afraid, and I went and told my president about it. I told people I trust, I'm afraid. This shouldn't be mine. It's the church's thing. And I'm suddenly hit with ethical questions. What if I decided to sell something? That would be unethical. To use this influence now to sell stuff? No, this... it's just an example of what all of us can be doing. And if not you, then people that you make sure are doing it under your leadership. If you yourself don't have a burden, make sure you bring in people who do. And geeks are ready and standing online to do it. There are, I would like be honored to like help you guys. Because you don't know what you're doing. And I'm a sophomore computer science major. Whoa. because you guys don't like know what you're doing. Bring in the geek. Watch what the geek will do to your office and put your face and name on it. If you can't do it, make sure someone's with you doing it. But folks, if we don't get on, somebody else will. Why am I saying this? We are living in urgent times. Time is of the essence. We must get out of our boxes. We must climb out of our silos. We must look at ministry with new eyes. The disciples were so shocked. The men in training to do the apostolate after he was gone still didn't get it until after his resurrection. We can't wait to get it till after his second coming. We must get it now. And if you refuse to get it, do not hinder those who got it. Do not pass policies to forbid those who have been called to act. God is going to mobilize millions of Adventists who reach out to thousands within their spheres. In the name of Jesus, we impact these conversations and plus the evangelistic meetings, the public, the things that are happening in our sanctuaries begin to change. And somewhere along the line, we have to resolve this issue of music. When this instrument came into the church was massively divided. Whole congregations were split. Why? Because the piano came into the sanctuary, the instrument of the devil. And then Bach brought the demonic organ into the temple. Then those people died, and now God loves those instruments. Okay. And so then the King's Heralds were singing for HMS Richards Jr., and they had to sign a committee to censure them, to help them, because their music was too jazzy. And Joshua went to battle around Jericho. If you can snap your fingers, the Lord was not in it. They were not allowed to sing black spirituals at first because that was even more than jazzy. And now the King's Heralds... What's happened to the good music among us? The guitar, in 1973, I was made to sit in the front pew because if someone sees the guitar, you could hear it but not see it. Now that's the way with the drums. You can hear them but not see them. And as people die, the Lord changes his mind about music. I am God, I change not. Now, I'm not asking you to like this music or like that music. What I'm saying is, who are we to tell the Holy Spirit how to do his work and how not to do this work? I know I'm going to get some letters on this. Be merciful unto me. I know I'm still a sinner, but you don't travel as much as I do. I make it my business at my peril, and that's changing, so I'm tired. I'm not that kid anymore. And I hear a band here that's scaring the daylights out of me. Definitely not my music. And I make an appeal and over 300 people make decisions for baptism. God used that band in my presence. I saw it with my own eyes. You cannot tell me. That's how the hardened heart responds. 300 souls. Yeah, but the music, it's not proper. Did you not see? Did you not hear what the Holy Spirit did in the people's lives? A homeless project up here in the state of conference. They said, we don't feed the homeless. You feed dogs, you feed cats, you feed cows and sheep and goats, but you serve the homeless. Just by hearing their philosophy, I already knew where they were going. And they get together on Sabbath to cook warm food and take it to the people on the streets. And it came up in the board. Is this appropriate Sabbath behavior? Sometimes seeing, we do not see. Hearing, we do not hear. We must not allow our hearts to remain hardened. Guess who carries this burden? You and I do. We can stand at a blessed event where the Holy Ghost clearly moved, and a single individual with a stack of Ellen White quotes can bring reproach on the entire event, and nobody holds that person accountable. That's your job. That's my job. To allow someone to single-handedly destroy the effect of God's blessing just because they have an Ellen White quote taken out of context, I don't think so. You see what I'm saying? Now, brothers and sisters, I know that I have said far too much. I obviously do not care about my career. But I stand before you in the fear of the Lord. Because I'm out there. I'm seeing these things with my own eyes. Something's happening out there. And it's bigger than you and me. And too many of our people's hearts are hardened. They don't see it. They don't hear it. As leaders, we are called to awakening. God says two things that are despicable in Scripture. Number one, if you are neither hot nor cold, if you neither believe or disbelieve, if you're lukewarm, I'm going to vomit you. That is gross. Don't tell me that while I'm eating. If you doubt, see, the problem with doubters is they think they're believing. Well, I believe in the Sabbath. I'm just not sure about it. See, that's doubt. Lucifer began with doubt. It's more insidious than cancer because doubt always leads to unbelief. God will vomit us. The second time that God is despicable is through the prophet. Our righteousness is like a filthy rag. That's a menstrual rag. That's our righteousness. My daughters are so, oh, that is so gross. So I agree. So if you think you're that good without the blood of Jesus covering you, you're just a filthy rag. And here we think we're good. That's what a hardened heart does. It is time to be clothed in his righteousness, an imparted righteousness that leads to an imputed righteousness so that we reflect his character. This is our time, church. I want to challenge you. I've said far too much for you to register, but I hope you've been provoked to converse about this for the rest of the day. If you need to beat on me, at least give me the dignity of taking me outside. It gives me the chance to run. As I play this song in the presence of God, if you sense that the Lord has called your leadership, I have stopped growing. It is time to go to a new level. If the Lord has called your leadership to rise, as I sing this song, come forward as we conclude this program. Oh Lord, you're beautiful. Your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. Is all I see, and when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. Oh Lord, you're beautiful, your face is all I see. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. Oh, Señor, entrego, te doy mi corazón.
Your face is all I see, and when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. The hand of the Lord is upon you. The hand of the Lord is upon us, for he has brought us to this place. Can it be that indeed we are the last generation? Do you believe? Do you disbelieve? Or do you doubt? Well, I believe, but leaders today either believe or disbelieve. Which one's it going to be? Let us pray a prayer of anointing. Reach forward a hand of anointing to the person around you, in front of you. Let us pray for the outpouring of the Spirit of God upon our sphere of influence. This was not a message of rebuke. This was a message of calling. God is calling us to look a little higher, to see something we have never seen, that we may do something we have never done. Let us now see the hand of the Lord lead us to places we have never been. Are you ready? I could not be more sincere. I'm speaking from the bottom of my heart. I know that I wish my delivery was better. I'm very frustrated with myself. I wish I could say things right, but you're stuck with my brokenness. The foolishness of preaching is that God uses a devastated human being to do a divine thing. And if he can take this punk off of the streets of LA, I know he'll take you farther. Do you hear my heart? Okay, let's go into anointing. Let's bow our heads in his presence. Our Father in heaven, pour out upon us the Holy Spirit. Enough crawling, O Lord. Enough sitting in a nest and screeching from the heights of our office. Push us off. We have been falling helplessly, but may we realize we have wings to fly and soar to levels we never imagined even existed. May we disappear into the clouds and be able to see thousands of miles in all directions. May we now fulfill our destinies. Doesn't matter what title we possess here, Lord. The only question is, are we filled with the Holy Ghost? Lord, you don't need men. You don't need women. You don't need children or youth or young. You need everybody. So, Lord, come upon us, breathe on us as you breathed on the disciples that day. Back then it was addition, 3,000 were added in a day. Now with what technology is available, it's multiplication. 1 million can be added in a day. 20 million can be multiplied in a day. We have the people. We have the technology. We have the leadership. Today, we have the will. So now, Lord, we want to have the power of the Holy Spirit lead us. Please look upon us, O Lord, for we are broken. Heal our brokenness and take the dysfunctions of our organization. Cut through the humanity and do a divine thing. Sir, we would see Jesus among us. May we put away the foul tongue and the criticism and the condemnation among us. May we look heavenward now and speak of this work that we cannot finish. So we're now ready to be your witnesses. We're ready to watch you finish it through us, through our people. May we be reduced to witnesses watching you. And finally, Lord, teach us to pray. Please teach us to pray, to come to you in a relationship so real that we're talking with you throughout the day. So now, Lord, we conclude. May this provocation been strong enough that we talk about it for the rest of the day. May we not forget about this and go back into mundaneness. May we sense that you have called me, each one of us, directly. Lord, we go now to seminars and to activities, but we go in your name. May others who look upon us say, what happened to you? You're glowing. And may we tell them, I have looked into the face of God. In his name we ask. For the of his kingdom and our sphere of influence, for his glory and all of it. Do not forget, go and tell someone only what you have seen. Go in peace.